Let's see. All right, Greg's biting at the bit. Kick us off, Greg. Oh, maybe not.
I accidentally hit the wrong button, but
right.
hi to Dave Hall.
Here's this, she hears this from Smithville. Well, good, we're making it that far.
Smithville, Virginia.
Or Smithfield. Sorry.
Smithfield, Virginia. Yeah. I've never been there. Been to Virginia a bunch of times,
You would
but
think we're
never
from there.
might be. Well, we had a good group today at the 12 o'clock hour and a good discussion. And hopefully tonight we'll have the same. If you have any questions about Transformation Prayer Ministry, we would be happy to try to address those. I'm assuming that you all are reading through the material, you're watching the videos, and that your questions will flow from that content of information that you've been studying and reading and applying. And but we're happy to try to maybe troubleshoot any issues you may be having or in your ministry sessions.
Well, shoot, just in those four comments in a row, that's all corners of the states anyway. We got Virginia, Florida, Chicago, and Los Angeles.
There we go. We got all four corners of the United States.
Everybody else,
Everyone's in
U.S.
the
citizens anyway, or somewhere in between.
Yeah.
New Hampshire.
New Hampshire. All right, now we got it covered. We got a, we've
There you go.
established our perimeter.
And
So you can post your comments and questions in the chat. If you're watching on YouTube or if you're on the website, transformationprayer.org, obviously, if you're watching there, you already know that. But we encourage you to come on to Zoom. So on the broadcast page, transformationprayer.org/TPM live, there's instructions there on how you can register. It's free. You sign up, it takes 2 minutes, and then you can join us in Zoom, and then we can actually converse with you through either just audio. If you want to call in, you can use your phone, or if you've got a computer or a smart device that has a camera on it and microphone, you can go that way, and we can chit chat and then be able to see your beautiful face. It makes it a little easier to talk to a human being through a computer than talk to a computer.
Okay, we got any hands up in the Zoom section there?
Not yet. Everybody's sitting on their hands. That's right.
Carol hasn't had a question in a long time. I think she must be just mastering the material and just I know the people down there in Australia, I mean, they're a day ahead of us, so they're probably a thought ahead of us as well.
That's probably true. She's probably working on the new version that we haven't finished yet.
Probably so.
Oh, yeah, you kicked the beehive. Incoming.
Hi, Carol.
Hi guys, how are you going?
We're doing good. Like your hairdo.
Oh, thank you. Yes, got it all chopped off. Warwick doesn't like it, but there we go.
Well, that just makes it all the sweeter.
That's right. Yes, even more fun. I was wondering, so I mean, I've been around for a long time, as you know, long enough to weasel my way into the family. And but more and more, I see you guys putting the emphasis on the purpose and the principles, and I think for us in struggling to introduce TPM to our local church, I think that we didn't do a good enough job of emphasizing the purpose and the principles. And although I feel as though I'm very familiar with with them, I don't feel fluid in, I guess, discussing them. You
Sure.
know, the examples that you give where you say, oh, you know, this happened, and then straight away this principle comes to mind and I talk about it in this way. And I was wondering whether it seems to me, and I may be wrong in this, but it seems to me that over the last 6 weeks, that the level of questions about process have started to go down. And so I was thinking that it would be really helpful if you did like a little seminar presentation on the purpose and the principles, sort of like you would do if you were doing a live seminar, to kind of really hone us in on not so much when to use what principle, but just the overall, you know, this is, I mean, I have my little documents that I've summarized from the big documents talking about the purpose, the principles and the process, mm-hmm. but you guys do it much better than we do. So what do you think about that for an idea?
Well, I think that I'm going to ask you just to wait a little bit on that because our plan, once we finish this revision, is to do just that.
Right.
Is to walk you through the whole thing. And so let us, rather than just jumping in and just kind of shooting from the hip, let us polish it up so that the presentation is clean and clear. But no, I think it's a great idea. And I think that once we finish the revision, then we will take week by week and we will just start presenting this material front to back. But yeah, that's our plan.
And as far as knowing when to bring in what principle, you know, when to have what conversation, if you're talking about the context of a TPM session, so in which I'm functioning as the mentor, I'm sitting across from somebody who's learning, getting a feel for it, then the principles are always going to be at play, especially when we get into actually applying the process. No matter what stage of the process they're in, there's obviously going to be opportunities to talk about the process itself, as in what they're supposed to be doing, as their objectives, how to accomplish them. And then attached to every one of those is a subset of principles that explain why that's important or how to accomplish it. And then sort of the overarching theme of the whole thing would be to discuss the purpose. And so if you're in a TPM session, it's kind of fair game. It's more of a matter of figuring out what would be the most appropriate thing to talk about or to discuss or to introduce, because there's always going to be something to talk about. No matter what's happening, there's always some set of principles or some aspect of the process or, and purpose that you can be talking about in that moment. But if it's more for you're just on an airplane or at church or, you know, waiting for your food at a restaurant or something, a lot of the same things apply. Where I would tweak it is hold off on the process side of things, you know, because there's no sense in bringing it in, because it's as though you're describing the use of a tool, but you haven't yet discussed the purpose of it, the job that it's designed to, you know, to be used in, the context that it's designed to be used in, what is the problem that it's designed to solve. Yeah. You know, but if you're just telling me how that works, then I'm going to have to fill in those gaps.
Yeah, and almost always, if you start with the process in explaining, they immediately will react because they think you're saying, oh, you think I have problems.
Right.
You know, and I want to say, no, I know you do. That's not my point. I know you
that's
do.
That's self-evident. We can move past that.
But so they just react and their walls go up. I think, let me back, let me say this, Carol, is that it's pretty much a given for me. If I'm doing TPM with someone and this is their first session with me, then I will explain the principle that we feel we believe, because I want them to understand today we're going to focus on emotion and here's why we're going to do that. I pretty much every person that walks in is telling me why they feel what they feel because of their wife, their husband, their job, right, their situation, la 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 la. And so that's obviously they need to understand the principle that nobody or nothing is causing you to feel what you feel. So I'm going to bring that one in there. Next thing I want to do is that this is not a memory hunt ministry. We're not on a scavenger hunt here. We are going to focus on emotion, and I want to talk about association. How did God design your mind to work? Because in a few moments, we're going to focus on what you feel, and that is going to cause your mind to remember something. So I want them to understand that principle. And then from that point after that, pretty much I just kind of let them tell me what principle don't they know? Mm-hmm. Because whatever they tell me, their body, I mean, their reaction, their words, their whatever they say is saying, here's what I know about the principles.
Right. They're constantly expressing their current understanding.
If they say to me, I don't know nothing, my emotion just went away, I don't feel anything. Well, they just told me they don't understand the principles of solutions. So I'm going to take the time to explain solutions in that moment. They say, you know what, my wife, if she'd just leave me alone, I would. They just told me they need to be talk about the principle of we feel what we believe, and nobody can cause you to feel what you feel. So they're telling me what I need to introduce them to. Mm-hmm. And now here's where association works. When that person goes, my mother never blah, 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 that should cause my mind to associate to that principle.
Right.
You know, but if I don't know that
principle. It has to be there first.
Exactly. If I don't know that principle, then I'll just sit there and go, yeah, I know. My wife should do the same thing to me, you know. So we have to have it already internalized. And if it is, then our mind will associate to the principle right. that we're hearing them tell us that they don't know about.
Right.
And so that's really how I function in every ministry session.
Yes, and I think it in ministry sessions, it's fairly intuitive for me. I guess my problem is that I'm always thinking in terms of TPM in other conversations. So mm-hmm. particularly we in our Bible study group, we're doing a series on getting to know Jesus better. And so straight away, I kind of think, well, I only know one way to get Jesus to know Jesus better. Mm. It's.
I know you are a party spoiler. I know that.
Yes.
And that.
Yes.
And me too. See, I right. can't go to a small group without making a mess.
Right.
Yeah.
And I the only way I cannot make a mess is just be quiet, because someone will say something. And then the rest of the group starts coming in along beside them saying, you poor thing, let's pray for you, blah, blah, blah. I'm going, no. Mm-hmm. That's not what needs to happen here. But I can't say that. I've got to be quiet, let things happen, and then slowly interject. And when I do, the room gets quiet. Mm-hmm. And I realize they're not ready to hear this.
No.
My problem, I think, is what feels true to me is that the time is short, and that I don't know these people overly well. We've only been in this area for a few years, but I care about them. They're mostly older than us, and I try and introduce concepts in the context of my own life. I say, well, I believe that if I really knew who I was in Christ, then this would not be a problem for me.
Right.
And try and kind of work it around that way. But then I sort of feel like I need to then whip out my notes and go, now, which concept, which principle?
Right. Well, that's exactly where my brain went. Because if I'm sitting in your small group and I don't know what you're talking about, mm-hmm. I would ask, what are you talking about? Support that.
That's right.
Because you can't just make that claim. You're going to have to win me over, me in particular. You're going to have to walk me through the reasoning behind why you think knowing God is somehow the answer to what we're talking about here. But that is where I think the principles sort of shine is, yes, within the context of a TPM session, but almost more so outside of what's considered to be the TPM session, when we're just conversing, when we're just talking about stuff, because that's where it can fit in, because it applies to what we talk about in TPM, but it obviously also applies to what we do out there in the real world, outside of the context of TPM. Because if the principles are true, then they're true all the time. They're not just true when I focus on what I'm feeling. They're true when I'm driving down the road. They're true when I'm sitting in a small group. They're true when I'm brushing my teeth. And so one of the aspects of the coming update that I think will help with this particular thing, or at least maybe flatten the learning curve a little bit, is done our best to consolidate and organize and boil down to the absolute bare bones essentials, not necessarily reducing things, but trying to go to what is bedrock when we talk about principles. Start there so that we can then build up. Because otherwise, you make a claim like, well, if I just knew the truth in my heart about Jesus, then I wouldn't be tempted to do this nonsense over here. They're going, what are you talking about? Because it's too big of a gap. You mm-hmm. can't just come in with that, because you're going to sound crazy. Mm-hmm. So you kind of have to start way back at the basics of the basics and then build your way up. But any one of those work as a conversation starter. They work as kind of an icebreaker a transition from the current conversation we're having about how awful your wife and your job and your boss and the situation is and how the world's falling apart and everybody's feeling, you know, whatever. You can start anywhere and start moving in the direction of understanding what we're talking about. You know, but you have to have those sort of on-ramps or front doors already established, not only obviously in the training, but in your mind. So that's what you're associating to is what is the fundamental concept that they're not getting right here? Mm-hmm. And I know that only because of how they're acting or what they're describing, you know, how they're talking about it. It tells me you don't understand this basic principle. So we can start there. And it's something that wouldn't be threatening. It's not, you know, real heavily theological or anything. It's just bare bones essential stuff that if you can get that, then we can move on to another one. Or we can add another kind of fundamental and then add those together. And then talk about this other, you know, kind of second tier principle. So trying to bring in in a sense, because you've got history with it, similar or in like fashion to how the process itself was one thing and then it got organized and structured and laid out and now we're drowning in maps and diagrams and all that. So an aspect of that same kind of renovation we're trying to bring into the principles themselves so that it's cleaner, it's easier to see what's what and see the order of it. And, you know, like what you're saying, where do you start? You know, what kind of conversation are you supposed to start with? Because if you start in the wrong spot, you're probably not going to get any traction because you're just going to lose them. Mm-hmm. So as it is right now, basically, we're tentatively calling it the fundamental principles. As of today, don't hold me to it, there's only four. So that gives you options, and it's manageable. And from there, you can then build on to any of the other principles that we talk about. Mm-hmm. But if you can get these four basic ones, which any one of them are an easy conversation piece, easy one to, you know, go from wherever they are, then you have somewhere to build. But it kind of goes back to what we were saying. Let it cook for a little bit longer, you know, before we can actually do it justice. Because whatever we throw out there, everybody's going to run with. And so we want to be able to give you the best we can, you know, our first attempt.
I have noticed this over the last 25 years of trying to share this ministry with the world. In the same way that not everyone in the world is ready to hear the gospel, only those that God has prepared for and their heart is ready, the soil mm-hmm. is cultivated and the seeds find root. I find the same way in the church with true believers. Not everyone is ready to hear these concepts and principles.
Which can be explained with the principles.
Yeah. But I mean, I think about my own journey prior to the late 80s anyway. Well, probably 79 was a turning point for me. But after that point, I would have had a problem with someone sharing these things with me. I would have reacted to them. I would have pushed back on them, you know. But God had to move me to a place. And he had to give me several years of failure in counseling, basically, to get to the place where I'm saying, I quit. It's not working, you know. Well, now God's going, maybe you'll listen. You know, maybe I can. But see, I had to come to a place where I could even receive what God wanted to teach me in this. And so I recognize that not everyone is ready. So when I start sharing, was a guy that my office is a local restaurant where I have my computer pretty much every day. And I've gotten to know some of the regulars that hang in there and so forth and the girls that, you know, waiting the tables and stuff. And there's one old fellow there that he asked me one day what I did, and I sat down with him and I shared the principles and concept with him, and that was the last time he asked me. You know, he has never asked me again. And I don't think he's ready. You know, he said he was a believer. He said he, you know, was a follower of Christ and all that. But when I started talking about these, I could tell it on his face. He wasn't ready mm-hmm. for that, you know. And, but that's all right. I mean, I threw the seed down on the ground anyway. We'll see what happens, you know. Mm-hmm. And maybe at some point he'll come back, but.
But what we're talking about is getting better at casting seeds so that if and when they do find the right spot, we got it where it needed to be.
I think where we get in the way is when we try to cultivate the soil.
Yeah.
You know, we want to get in there
and encourage them.
We want to break it all up ourselves, you know. And people don't typically appreciate that. Well, no one, I don't think anybody really appreciates God cultivating the soil.
Right.
You know, we kick and cuss and fuss and carry on, but God goes ahead and breaks it up anyway.
Right.
And then the seeds find a place to germinate. But
and they can much more easily escape you. So, yeah, after your first failed attempt, now you're on their radar.
Mm-hmm. All right. Well, we're waiting in anticipation for the new teaching. So I think you guys should work harder.
I know. We're useless.
I'm waiting on Joshua to finish up his part of it.
I'm working on it.
Josh.
I know. You think you guys are the only ones griping at me, don't you?
All right, folks. Somebody else got a question?
John?
Hey. I'll
bring you up.
Here?
I hear you.
Yep.
I just don't see you yet.
Oh, good. Yeah.
And now I see you.
Yeah. You should. It's on my end.
Hey, good. Thanks again. I always appreciate this time and your time. I've had a couple of live sessions this week with acquaintances, good friends. But boy, there's nothing like, maybe this is just me, but there's nothing like doing it. It kind of reminds me of my sports days. You know, you could study the playbook and practice, but something about being in the game.
Yeah.
And that's what I'm finding.
Right.
I have a comment and then I have a question. It really struck me that there's a skill in following and listening, especially, you know, you get in the emotion box and they can come at you pretty fast. And I'm finding that very interesting. So far the people I've recruited to work with me have found it very insightful and helpful. So so that's the comment. It takes some skill, you know, in listening especially. That's what I'm finding out. So then my question, one of my potential candidates suffers from insomnia. And after I heard your story last week, Ed, about vomiting,
mm-hmm.
you know, I thought, well, why not insomnia? And, you know, this is a person who's healthy and Christian, you know, doesn't drink coffee before they go to sleep. They just can't sleep.
Mm-hmm.
And that doesn't do well. That has a lot of negative impact
on
one's life. And so I want to sit down with this person and go through the process. And since you're here, I'm going to take advantage of you. And I look at the first question. I know how does that make it feel right now. Tired's going to be the first answer. But is that where to start? You know, okay, besides tired, how, you know, is it disturbing that you can't sleep? How does that make you feel? Am I on the right track? Or
well, I think where I would go, and it would just be about orientation.
Right.
I would say to him, you know, maybe tonight while you're lying in bed and you're trying to fall asleep, just listen inside and just feel what you're feeling and make note of that. Because I'll bet you, I will say this, if his insomnia is tied into his belief, and that's what's causing him not to fall asleep, then I would want him to be introspective and listen and to feel and to evaluate what's going on while I'm laying here and I'm wide awake. And he has to look inside and really, and I have to do this with myself, just look inside and be really honest about what's happening, what I'm feeling. And sometimes it's very, very subtle. It's not screaming emotion. It's just a very, very subtle, low hum almost of anxiety or stress or concern or worry. And let him identify that. Put it back on him and say, you know, when you go home tonight, lay in bed, just you focus on it and you figure it out.
Mm-hmm.
And when we get back together again, we'll talk about that. Because rather than saying, how does it make you feel not to go to sleep, that's probably not going to tie you into the emotion that may be behind that.
Right. Now, well, he may, especially if the act of not falling asleep is a solution behavior, because it's the opposite that you'd want to get at. You know, it's not the thought of falling asleep, because that probably it's not the thought of not sleeping, because that's if it is in fact a solution behavior, then that will feel better, even though counterintuitive, than the thought of falling asleep.
Yeah.
If that any of what I just spit out on you made sense.
No.
Okay.
Yeah.
So and not to say that it is a solution behavior, but if it is, then that would be the dynamic that it. The emotion would be associated with the opposite direction.
I know this about my own self. If I'm having difficulty falling asleep, my mind is not numb and nothing's going through my mind. I'm having all kinds of thoughts and things.
Mm-hmm.
And that's why I can't, because I'm consciously aware.
Right.
And it's really hard to fall asleep when you're consciously aware that you're not falling asleep.
Right. I can't think of a time in which I realized, I'm not falling asleep.
Yeah.
I'm very much aware of the fact that I'm not falling asleep.
And so there's conscious activity going on there, and that's what I want them to focus on to figure out what's going on inside your head while you're laying there.
You're not sleeping anyway. You may as well look into
it. And what is that causing you to feel?
Right.
Yeah, all right.
Okay. And then have them bring that back in the session. That's where I would work. Mm-hmm. See what happens.
I'm glad I asked. Mm-hmm. That's it for today.
All right.
Thank you.
Appreciate it.
Mm-hmm. Yeah, speaking of the negative effects of sleep insomnia, there it was. But mine's, I think, more related to all the little bodies who somehow end up in my bed every night, even though I put them back in their place continually. Little kids. My kids, just for clarification.
Got a question here. It says, I have much more anger now that I'm aware of TPM principles than I used to. I think this means I'm not using my previous solutions of behavior modification. Let me just generally answer that, Elizabeth. It's not uncommon at all for people when they start down this journey, and as they begin to identify the solution beliefs that they are harboring, and they start getting truth about those things, and those solutions no longer become available to them.
And they're becoming more aware of what to look for as it relates to solutions.
Then what tends to happen is people do tend to feel more often. Mm-hmm. They're more connected to their emotion.
Aware of
and,
it.
And if your solution is anger, well, if you're angry, then that is your solution. Then what's probably happening is as you're getting closer and touching those lie-based beliefs that are causing emotion, your go-to solution may be anger, and if it is, well, then you're going to have an increase in anger because you have an increased awareness of the lie-based pain, you got to deal with it, and it may be the way you deal with your pain is through anger. That's a real common way people deal with their emotional pain is through anger. So, no, I would say you're right on track. Just don't give up. Just embrace it. It's a gift. And
and the fact that you are at least consciously aware of the fact that you're angry and also that is a solution behavior puts you way ahead of the curve.
Right.
So
right.
You're moving in a good direction. So right. I think where a lot of people trip up is in becoming more conscious or aware of all the stuff that's going on. Somehow that seems like it's worse than where they were. And it may feel worse than being able to just automatically without thinking engaging in this solution and that solution and blaming him and doing this and doing that. But it's a much healthier place to start becoming aware of what's actually going on so that you can actually then address it. Because otherwise you're just distracted and blinded and busy. Let's see, we got a couple hands up. Matt, we'll bring you on. And it looks like you got...
Thanks. Go. Oh, my camera's messed up on my phone.
All right, you're good.
Well, okay, I'll just kind of keep it. That's great. Yeah, I'll just go on audio. So,
like you said, grease smeared over your lens.
Yeah, well, it's smashed. I got to get this fixed. So in a recent mentoring session, the mentee, in response to the second question in the solution box, said, I would, you know, either do or avoid, do the right behavior, basically, if I were able.
Okay.
So I'm asking, so what do you believe would happen if you did, you know, the opposite of what the solution was? So there was two examples. One, this person, it was a sin behavior that they wanted to avoid. And then in another session, it was moving forward, you know, they're letting the emotion they're feeling connect them up with something from the past.
Right.
And they got, you know, that typical block, you know, blank screen, I'm not feeling anything. So in both of those cases, when I asked, well, what do you believe would happen if you ... they said, well, I would do basically insert the right thing. I would do the right thing if I were able. So there's this belief that that they're just not able to do this. And I said, I think my response was, well, what do you believe would happen if you were able?
Okay.
You know, but I'm wondering, like, what is your take about that? When the mentee thinks, well, you know, I'm not doing this, or the process isn't working because I'm just not able to move forward.
Mm-hmm. Well, it goes back to, and you could probably answer this yourself, you're going to have one of two options, maybe a combination of the two. So the first is what? It's going to be that they just don't know what they're doing. It's just a matter of ignorance. They're unfamiliar with their role, with this part of the process, with the principles that apply to it. They just don't know any better. Okay. Mm-hmm. But you also have the potential, and that's kind of the direction that you went, is another solution behavior that they're engaged in. And so that would have been perfectly fine to move in the direction of treating the thought that I'm incapable or I'm not able to it, you know, it's impossible for me to do it. Well, that obviously could very well be a solution behavior, just along with everything else we do and think. So it's one of those things where, yeah, it could be where you've heard us in the past say what we typically do is if it seems like it could go either way, address the potential ignorance first. You know, there's another opportunity to talk about some concepts and principles and that sort of thing. And then move over into the solution box if necessary after that. If they're going, okay, yeah, no, I get it, but I still just feel like I can't do that. Okay, well, now we know what we're dealing with at least. So it's right. It's going to be one of those two things. And based upon those two particular solutions, my money would be on the ignorant side of things even more so than solution. I don't doubt at all that, you know, obviously both of those could be solution behaviors, but there's probably also a heavy dose of needing orientation.
Yeah, when a person responds to the second question with a positive answer, mm-hmm. it just tells you they don't understand what they're supposed to be doing with that question.
Right, they don't know what they're looking for.
Right, and so when you say, you know, what would happen if you were to let go of your anger? Well, I'd be in a better place. Mm-hmm. Well, that's true. That's the right answer, but that's not the purpose of the question.
Right.
And so at that point, they're telling me they don't understand what they're supposed to be doing right there.
Right. And maybe that's kind of it's probably obvious to everybody, but there's a good example of an appropriate time to bring in or to start a conversation on principles or process to offer orientation in that moment. Because you have to sort of take on the mentality of interpreting everything that they do and say as them communicating what their current level of understanding is as it relates to TPM. So if they go, like the example he just gave, if they respond to that second question in the solution box with the positive or the right answer or something that's logical and probably true, then what does that say about their current understanding? That's what you kind of have to get in that mode of is, what are you actually telling me about what you know? And so if they're going, oh, I'd feel so much better. Okay, red flag, you don't know what you're doing.
Yep.
Okay. Well, that's now my job, obviously, is to help you get better, have a better idea of what you're doing. And so that's where I would step in as mentor.
Yeah, no, I'm following what you're saying. And Ed, there have been instances with this particular mentee where there has been a positive response. And then I immediately knew from the memory box flowchart, and it kind of flows logically, right? I mean, so right. Then what is it about doing the right thing that makes you resist and hesitate doing so? Mm-hmm. And I think there may be an answer to that question. Well, you know, it's just that I'm just not able. So I did, like after the session, explain a little bit more about solutions. Mm-hmm. I explained about my experience where sometimes you have to just trust what you're learning in the process and the principles that, you know, when you get a blank screen, or if anger comes up, or you go numb, or you believe you can't do it, that you just start working through that in the solution box, as just sort of trusting that, okay, I'm blocked. It's not the process's fault, it's me.
I'm doing or missing,
Yeah, I kind of explained that after, but there were one or two times where with the answer, like, well, I would do it if I were able. It's like, well, I just don't have the ability. I kind of got a little stumped, but, or at least I went the route of like, well, that may be a solution, you know, like a conclusion or a vow, right? Well, I can't do it. You know, I'm just not able. I didn't feel confident doing that. So I wanted to run that by you.
Yeah, something that came to my mind as you were talking there is that when a person says, I'm just not capable of doing that, it may be they didn't understand the first question.
Or that they don't understand what they're intended to do. Because it may be that they're incapable of doing whatever they think they're going to do.
Okay. Let me back up.
Okay,
you just be quiet for a second. It may be that they have, the first question is, do you sense any hesitation or resistance at the thought of doing whatever it is you were, you know, there was. And it may be they didn't understand that question, because if they felt hesitation and resistance right there, then when they got to the second question, the second question should make sense. So then what would happen if you did do that? Well, I'm not capable of doing that. I know, but you just told me you had hesitation and resistance to do it, if indeed they did. See, it may be that you got to go back and say, okay, let's just go back to that first question again. I want you to look inside and look for any pushback, any resistance, hesitation at the thought of doing this. I understand you don't believe you can do that, and I get that. You know, we are incapable of overcoming our sin and anything. I get that. But think about the hesitation, resistance at the thought of doing that, even if you were able to. Because if they don't sense the hesitation, resistance, that's the first step in the solution box is, they need to identify, hey, I am pushing back. I am resisting. I am not wanting to do something. Okay. Now, when they own that, now they're ready for the second question. But if they haven't identified that, the second question may not make sense to them.
And even taking it further than just not understanding the question, because this is one of, again, another update to the coming training, and specifically to the flowchart that you're referring to. So the most current, up-to-date version of the flowchart that's available publicly is what I heard you describing. The one you will have soon, coming out of that second question. So let's say they give this type of response. Rather than going into asking a different or a wording of the same question, or even offering orientation regarding that question, the coming current protocol will be to offer orientation on the concept of a perceived problem. Because that's what they're missing, is they don't know what they're looking for. So even if they understand your question, if they still don't understand the concept of a perceived problem, that which I'm attempting to solve by doing whatever I'm doing, then they're still just kind of blindingly grasping. And so you're still going to probably stumble around a bit. And so if the whole goal is to get them better at doing what they're doing by making it intentional so that they actually understand what they're doing and can do it on purpose, then that's where you need to focus at that point, is the concept of perceived problems. Because if they can get that, then there would never be any reason whatsoever to be giving these right answers, because obviously that's not what we're looking for. But if they are doing that, that at least tells us you don't understand what you are looking for, but you also may have a reason not to look for what you're supposed to look for. But at the very least, if I can explain perceived problems and then they still don't move forward, they still don't identify it, now we've taken the ignorance piece of it off the table. Because they do know what they're supposed to be doing. They do know, you know, what they're supposed to be looking for. So the fact that they're not doing that means they have reason for not doing that. Okay, so now we're just dealing with an additional solution behavior at that point. But it's a matter of, you know, process of elimination by way of orientation. You know, it's explaining the concepts so that they can't, so not that they can't, but they aren't ignorant. That option is off. And so it's just a matter of, again, figuring out what they need to know in the moment, focus there, offer some orientation. And then if it sticks, they'll be able to go back to applying the process a little more equipped and be able to figure out what was going on. Because it may just be that after orientation, they go in and realize, okay, no, I almost feel this compulsion to stay where I am, or this resistance and hesitancy to even owning this over there. Like, okay, well, I would have no way of knowing that. That's why it's important that you know what you're doing. So that because you're the one who's in there untangling stuff. It's not me. You know, I'm just watching you do it and hoping to basically equip you further so that you're better at doing that.
Well, if your image that you're showing us on the video is any sign of understanding us, it's pretty blurry. Oh.
No, sorry. I was on mute. I went on mute. But no, I just responded all of this is very helpful. I went back and read the second chapter on the solution, basically the solution box chapter about where it does say the emphasis on the question. The first question is not asked to do anything.
Right.
So I will remember that and maybe even mention that explicitly if I get that response anywhere in the solution box, you know, just that, you know, let's go back to the first question. I'm not asking you to do anything. I'm just asking you to look inside and sense, see if there's any resistance or hesitancy of a thought of doing something. Mm-hmm. Mm-hmm. So, okay. Thank you so much. Appreciate it.
All right, buddy.
All right, let's see. We've got hands up all over the place. All right, Byron, we'll bring you in. Have you unmute yourself?
Can you hear me?
Yeah, no, he's in the witness protection service, apparently.
Well, I'm backlit out of the mountain here in Chiang Mai. First of all, I want to say thank you for talking about keeping your mouth shut when you're talking to other people who don't understand it. And I found that has worked very well. Every now and then I'll say, well, you know, you really do feel what you believe. And I'll just, with this group that I'm working with, just gradually put some seeds in there. And it has helped me not put my foot in my mouth and get ostracized from groups by going too fast. So I've slowed down. One of the things that I like to try to do when explaining intellectual belief versus heart belief is your steakhouse example, Ed, of someone told me there's a good steakhouse at State and First, and I kind of believed it. But once I got there, I saw it was at State and Fifth, and I had a good steak dinner, and now you can't talk me out of it. Do you have any other examples like that to help people understand the difference between intellectual belief and heart belief?
Just what you have in the materials there, and especially the characteristics of intellectual belief versus the characteristics of heart belief. And that's, of course, all in the manual as well. I would say those are important. And then just the best illustrations are just your own life experiences that you can share with folks. Mm-hmm. And when I have a life experience, it becomes experiential for me, and you can't talk me out of it. I mean, you can talk me out of an intellectual understanding of something if I trust you and if I believe that you know what you're talking about. You know, then you could talk me out of my intellectual understanding. But even if I trust you and you think you know what you're talking about, you cannot talk me out of a life experience. If I've been to Disneyland, which I will probably never go again, but if I have been to Disneyland or whatever, and
or if you believe that you have.
Well, if I believe that I have.
Even if you haven't, if you believe that you have.
If I believe that I have, and I have, you know, that memory in my mind, you can't talk me out of that. You can't say, well, no, you never were there. You probably went to, you know, World Kingdom or something, but you've never been to. No, I've been there. I saw Mickey Mouse and Donald Duck. I know I was there, you know. And people talk about, well, you know, surely I can convince myself of the truth. Well, the truth is you can't even do that. I experienced that with those survivors of sexual abuse that I worked with in early years. you know, week after week after week, I would tell them the truth and they would agree with me. It wasn't my fault. I'm not there anymore. I'm safe now. It didn't make me dirty and shameful. I'm not trapped. I'm not going to die. I know that's the truth. Okay, now focus on your memory. What do you feel? And they would panic and start weeping and crying. And I would say, what's going on? Well, I know it's not true, but I feel dirty and shameful. I feel like I'm going to die. I feel like I'm out of control. Well, they couldn't talk themselves out of what they came to believe in the context of their life experience. Even though they knew the truth intellectually, they couldn't get past their heart belief. Right. And heart belief is fixed and it's static, and only God can convince us otherwise. Whereas our intellectual belief can be swayed and it changes, and it does change. I mean,
But for the same reasons. Because that's where, going back to the... I guess this would be an example of what we were talking about with Carol, I think, about the idea of kind of fundamental principles. So the fundamental principle specifically in that conversation would be this idea that we believe what we're persuaded to believe. That's true for intellectual belief. That's true for heart belief. It's and the reason for why, you know, heart belief seems, you know, immovable and static, and or why, at the very least, why it doesn't seem to change as often, is that those same requirements have to be met, but it's harder to meet them because of what my current belief is based upon. My current, you know, head knowledge, intellectual knowledge, is based on a body of information or a body of evidence that is much easy to disprove, let's say, than that which supports my heart belief, what I believe in my heart, you know, about myself, about my condition, about God. You know, those things are, they take a stronger argument, you know, and where we've landed is it takes an argument directly from the Holy Spirit. You know, he has to be the one that comes in bringing a heavier, more weighty body of proof with more authority that is more trustworthy than our own eyes and ears, and then that persuades us across. You know, and so it's, it goes back to, you know, where to start the conversation, because that idea that we believe what we're persuaded to believe is one that you can kind of plug in almost any conversation, but it's also one of the biggest, I don't want to say that. It is one of many places that the church is currently handicapped because we're trying to act in opposition to that principle that God's clearly put in place, and we try to convince ourselves and convince each other of the truth, and it just ain't sticking. You know, well, there's a reason for that. That's not how it works. You know, and so I just wanted to bring that, just because that was an easy example of kind of one of the fundamental principles at play that kind of is just beneath the conversation we're having, you know, about heart belief. And because if you try to start the conversation there, I'm already going to assume that I can just choose to believe whatever, even if you convince me of, you believe things in your head, you believe things in your heart, well, I'm still going to operate under the assumption that I can just choose to believe whatever I want, regardless of where it may be. Mm-hmm. You know, so you got to back it up to the bedrock and start there and then kind of build upon.
Yeah.
If that makes sense.
I mean, we can't even talk ourselves out of intellectual beliefs.
No.
I mean, I believe 2 + 2 = 4. But I cannot convince myself it's something different.
Right.
I can't do it. It's impossible.
Right. I mean, convince yourself that this doesn't say Panera Bread.
I can't do it.
Convince yourself that you don't think that's green. You can't.
Can't do it.
So it's not that somehow heart belief is special in that regard. The same rule applies to both. Yeah. It's just that requirement that has to be met in order for me to be persuaded is less frequently met with heart belief, and there's reasons for that. And
theoretically, it is possible that someone could come and talk me out of 2 + 2 = 4.
Sure.
If I've trusted them, and if they could actually intellectually show me that they have some mathematical reason that convinced me that, wow, I always thought it was 4, and it really isn't 4.
Well, talk to anybody who does anything in quantum mechanics. Yeah. 2 + 2 absolutely does not equal 4. Yeah.
So, I mean, it's just a matter of having, that's the trust and authority principle that we write about in the manual. So, anyway.
Right. Thank you. That helps.
Well, good. All right. Let's get one more question in tonight before we call it a night, if we can.
See David's hand up. Let's bring David in.
Yeah, this is just a suggestion I use for the difference. I call it heart belief, but I also call it experiential belief. which you, Ed, you used that term experience.
I used to.
Yeah. So I have on my computer, I have a little file of pictures of the Canadian National Tower in Toronto. Anybody ever been to the top of that tower?
I mean,
1,280 feet above ground level with a glass floor. You cannot stand on the glass floor and look down at the same time and remain on the glass. Very hard to do. Yeah, I looked up the engineering of that glass floor. It'll hold 600 pounds per square inch. And yet I don't weigh 600 pounds. And my foot's bigger than the square inch.
Right.
But I cannot stand on that glass and look down at the same time. Intellectually, I understand it'll hold me. Experientially, I can't, my eyeball can't see the ground 1,200 feet below, and I can remain stationary. And that's the difference between intellectual belief and felt belief.
Okay.
And it's also, yeah, we feel what we believe and we do what we believe and all those things intertwined. Yeah.
And we don't know. And we don't know that we believe things. We have solid beliefs that we don't even know we have.
Right. We're not conscious of. Yeah.
Not consciously. Yeah. No, that's very true. And, and a lot of times our experiential, I'm going to use your term, my old term that you're still using, the experiential beliefs, which are our heart beliefs. Now I use, I think biblically speaking, heart belief is more accurate, but the things we've learned by experience. I forgot what I was going to say.
I know. Well, that's part of the reason why we've phased out of that, because you learn everything you learn through experience. You never learn anything outside of your own experience.
But I like the experience, because I say in order for you to change how you feel about this thing, this belief that you have, because you feel it, you need another actual experience, a real concrete matter of fact experience with Jesus Christ.
And when the Lord says to me in my state of being where I'm going, I'm all alone by myself, and the Lord says, no, I'm right here with you, that is a experience.
Right.
Yeah, that is an experience. I'm having an experience which supersedes my other experience that taught me that I'm all alone and by myself. And that's what only God can do. I believe experientially. Now, I do believe that we can talk each other. I think that's the purpose in 2 Timothy 3:16 that says that the word of God is good for correction and instruction and reproving and all that kind of good stuff. Those are things we can do intellectually with each other.
Mm-hmm.
You know, you can say, you know, in the Bible in 1 Samuel 4:15 says that Moses went, I'm going, wait, what are we talking about, David? Moses wasn't in 1 Samuel. And let me show you why. And you're going to go, oh, gee, okay. Ed. And from that point forward, I have persuaded you.
Right.
Of the truth intellectually. But heart belief, I can't touch that.
Right. But God can do what you just did intellectually, but with this
with
other
heart.
Type of
yes.
belief. Yeah.
Yes. Yes.
Yeah. And that's where at this point we're using almost exclusively heart belief. And then if we do talk about what we believe intellectually in general, it's typically just tried to bring it even more to kind of man on the street language and say what you believe in your heart and what you believe in your head, you know, or heart belief and solution belief, because that specifically is what we're dealing with in the context of TPM. The belief that 2 + 2 = 4, who cares? So it doesn't matter in this conversation. And so if we're talking at all about intellectual belief, we're probably talking about solution beliefs. But that's kind of where the conversation is right now, is heart belief, solution belief, what you believe in your head, what you believe in your heart. And so it's simpler, if nothing else, but it's also done for more reasons than just making the vernacular, you know, easier.
All right. Well, David, good to see you again. Are you staying warm enough down there in Florida?
He's got his fan going, so that's probably a yes.
No, I'm in New Hampshire. We got here last night.
Oh, well, okay.
And we have no central heat.
Ew.
And it was 36 degrees last night.
Okay, well, you keep that to yourself. Okay, don't bring that down.
Yeah.
All right.
Take care, friend. Well, guys, it's been good to be with you again, and I hope these hours we spend with you are profitable and beneficial. And someday, I know that Matt's the one that's doing the time coding, right? On the
Greg.
Oh, Greg is. Greg's doing the time coding. We have a person who has volunteered to go back and watch the videos and listen for the questions, and is putting time codes in and identifying the questions. And I'd like to think that someday we can go back and put all of this on some kind of a list that will have all the questions, mm-hmm. and you just click the question, it'll take you to that video.
Yeah. That way, if you have a question, yeah, you can just do a little search or whatever.
And that's coming, but you know, I would like to think that God is going to raise somebody up to do that, other than us to do that. Somebody who has just a desire and a passion for that kind of technical thing, and would be willing to go back and identify all the questions and put them into some kind of a link where they could be accessed. That would be a really usable tool. Anyway, thank you guys for being with me, but thank you for also praying for us as we seek to try to get this training refined and done, hopefully releasing it soon. And as soon as we release the hard copy, the text, then we will immediately begin to do the new videos to go with all the text. And there's about 10 other projects right behind that. And we want you to have all of it. And we want to make it available to anyone in the world who wants it for free. And so that's that. And how we do it is because some of you all are supporting us financially. Mm-hmm. And we genuinely appreciate that. That's how we get this done.
We will crank out as much as we possibly can before the world falls apart.
Yeah. And but we get emails real often from people all around the world saying, thank you for making this available. Mm-hmm. It's changing our lives. It's changing our churches. And God is doing an incredible work based upon the reports that we're getting with this ministry. And some of you all are supporting us financially and making it possible. So thank you for that. We are grateful. And we don't typically send anything back out to you and say thank you for giving. And it's not because we don't want to. It's
just, we're not grateful.
It's just that the entire TPM staff is right here. We are it. And so everything that gets done, we're the ones that do it. And so that's one thing that we don't have time to do is to send a note. I mean, I can generate a computer note saying thank you for giving. I think that does happen.
Because that warms the heart.
As far as me personally, you know, being able to contact you, I can't do that. And I wish I could, but I can't do that. But anyway, but I also know that that's not the reason you're giving. That you're giving because God has stirred you to do that. So anyway, God bless each one, every one of you, and we'll see you next time. Join us at 12 o'clock next Monday, or you can join us at 8 o'clock, either time or both times. Until then, God bless you all.